So good evening to everybody. It's a pleasure to join you and to meet you today for this course. The organizer explained me that you come from different countries, so from Greece, from Cameroon, and from Ghana, And if I well understood, you are come all from the school activities. So you are not university students, no? So you just finished the school and begin to work or not? You've begun to work. Okay, perfect. And you work on what? Just to understand and to focus your activities, and so to let me understand the level of the lesson. And you? You work on, you just began
plants,
to work?
Growing plants.
Growing plants, mm-hmm. Also fruit tree or
ornamental plants.
Ornamental plants.
Yeah.
And Greece?
Yeah.
Ah, you are grown, so you are graduated.
Yes.
Okay. And where did you study? Okay, perfect. Okay. So, my topic will be water management in agriculture. So I will talk about the activities that must be done and how to have better knowledge and know-how about the water management in agriculture. So we have to say in these few hours a lot of things that behavior that has joining with the activities that are in the field, so in the soil that takes part in the plant, and also the climate and weather in the more big consideration. So first of all, I want to introduce the utilization of water in Europe, and then we focus in Italy and in Sicily, just to understand what are the utilization of water in our Europe. So agriculture has a great importance in the utilization of water. Nearly 50%, 42% of the water is used just for agricultural activities, for agricultural purposes. But urban civil utilization is only 18%, but of course it's growing more and more. And industry and energy production has got a lot of increasing activities and now occupies nearly 40% of water utilization. So what we have seen in the last years is that more and more agriculture utilization increased so much because a lot of new cultivation have been utilized and have been cultivated just with irrigation. A lot of crops that were not irrigated in the past, now in the last 50 years, more and more have been irrigated, and so its utilization has been more important. Of course, in the last years, in the last 30 years, the percentage of industrial and urban utilization increased more than agriculture because, of course, there have been the urbanization of a lot of areas in Europe, and so its utilization have been always more important in the last 30 years. Just to introduce and the units that we have to use for water, I want to begin to cooperate with you and ask some aspects just to have a better knowledge about how to calculate water and the units we use commonly. So when we talk about water, we express it in amount of water per unit area and per unit time. So we have to take in consideration the water, and so of course we use liters. normally. Here in Europe, we don't use inches or gallons, that are the units that are more used in USA or in Anglo-Saxon areas. Per unit area, so we can use a square meter, so normally we use a square meter, or of course we are talking about great areas, so we talk about hectares, and then per unit time. So we have to understand and take into account if we are talking about irrigation in a year, in a day, in an hour, or per second. La batteria è quasi scarica. Il computer.
Sì.
So you have the charge?
Si può collegare.
Ma non è mio il computer, era qui, l'ho trovato qui. Sì, grazie. So talking about the time. Normally, when we talk about irrigation, we can express it so in millimeters per day or millimeters per year. It depends on what time we are taking into account. But when we talk about millimeters of water, how much is this quantity of water, this amount of water? Are you used to understand how much is a millimeter? Because there are some calculations that we have to do to better understand this millimeter. Because normally we arrive from a millimeter to say that is 10 cubic meters per hectare. But how to arrive from 1 millimeter to 10 cubic meters per hectare? So we have to do this calculation that I want to do with you just to better understand how we can arrive to this amount. Because when we talk about a millimeter, we are talking about a millimeter of water per square meter. So if we say that in a liter it is about 1 cubic decimeter, it's like we are talking about a box, like the box we use in the house for water or for milk, that is 10 centimeters per 10 centimeters per 10 centimeters in height, large and depth. No? So if we have 10 centimeters per 10 centimeters per 10 centimeters, it's a box with 1 liter of water. But when we are talking about millimeters per square meter, we can convert millimeters in 0.01 decimeter, because 1 millimeter is 0.01 decimeters. Do you agree with me? Because 1 decimeter is 10 centimeters, so 0.1 decimeter is 1 centimeter. 0.01 decimeters is 1 millimeter. Is it clear for you?
Yes.
10 decimeters per 10 decimeters. That is a square meter, because normally we talk about a square meter that is 1 meter per 1 meter, but 1 meter is made of 10 decimeters. Are you okay? So this is the amount that we are talking about in a squared meter. Then, when we have to talk about the quantity of water in a hectare, of course, we have to take into account that a hectare corresponds to 10,000 square meter. So, 1 liter per 10,000 square meter corresponds to 10,000 liters per hectare. So at the end, 1,000 liters correspond to a cubic meter. So 10,000 liters correspond to 10 cubic meters. Do you understand all the passages? So it can be, when we read it, very easy. But normally, if after an hour I ask you again, how much does it correspond, 1 millimeter? Not everyone can easily say that it is 10 cubic meters, no? And that it corresponds to 10,000 liters per hectare. So just to take into account that we are talking about this amount of water per unit area, per unit of time. So, talking about irrigation in Europe, of course there is a lot of difference between Northern Europe and Southern Europe, because normally water used for irrigation in Northern Europe is useful for horticultural crops in dry years and on sandy soil. So it's a few of water utilized in Northern Europe and only for some crops. But normally not all the crops are irrigated. What happened instead of in the south of Europe is that irrigation is necessary for all crops, quite all crops, and I'm talking about tree fruit crops, so tree cultivated for obtaining the fruits in order with the aim of using fruits, but also trees that are used for ornamental purposes has the necessity of irrigation. No? So it's useful for Mediterranean species like olive and grapes that not always are irrigated. So there are some species, this is the concept, that can survive and are able to produce fruit and production also in absence of irrigation. But what is the reason to irrigate so in such species that are Mediterranean, so they are used to have this climate, and so they can survive also if they are not irrigated for a long time. But the quality and the quantity of the production is completely different if we are irrigated. For example, when we talk about olive, a lot of time that is the typical plant of the Mediterranean area. No? Olive are normally, if not irrigated, it doesn't produce each year. But we can observe that it produces a year on and a year off. So produces just 1 year every two. And this means that the productivity of the plant decreases a lot, and also the efficiency of the production decreases a lot. So it's useful to understand that also in this species, if we are able to irrigate, we obtain a greater and amount of production and, of course, a better quality of the production. Why we irrigate? We irrigate because the difference between the evapotranspiration and the rains has got a lot of difference, especially in the spring and summer time, where the evapotranspiration is very high and the quantity of rains are less normally, not so much in Northern Europe, but very, very much in Southern Europe. So you can see here that the difference is the red part, means that we are obliged, we must irrigate just to not have any stress for the plant. For example, here, just to focus about the difference in Italy, I put the yearly water deficit that we can obtain in northern Italy, that is Cesena, and the plain of Catania. So it's near here, near where we are now, but you can see it's very, very hot in the summertime. And it's not a wet, also in summer, it's not a wet weather. It's a very dry weather. So the demand from the atmosphere of evapotranspiration, now I explain it better, what is evapotranspiration, is higher. So what we see, that in Cesena, so in North Italy, we have a lot of evapotranspiration, but some rains that made that the difference at the end of the year is not so much. It's nearly 150 millimeters. But here, instead, in Sicily and the plain of Catania, the difference between evapotranspiration demand and rains It means that is 700 millimeters. So if I ask you 700 millimeters, how many cubic meters are? Now it's easy. We have just told before. Do you remember 700 millimeters, how many cubic meters are?
7,000 cubic meters.
7,000 cubic meters are really a lot, because now again, 7,000 cubic meters, how many liters are? How much liters are? 7,000 cubic meters.
7 million liters.
7 million liters is a lot just for an hectare. So you have to multiply for all the hectares you have to irrigate. So just in 3 slides, we understand how much water is needed in our area and the necessity to irrigate just to have this better production for our evapotranspiration. Now I introduce evapotranspiration. Evapotranspiration is made of 2 processes, evaporation and transpiration. So we are talking about a physical activity that is due to the, of course, of the sun and due to the characteristics of the soil, so evaporation, and there is not it's only a loss of water from the ground to the atmosphere. No? And transpiration. Transpiration is not a physical process. Transpiration is a physiological process, because evaporation happens whatever we do, because we can do anything. The water demand is high, the water loss from the ground, so from the soil, is high. And we can only cover with plastic the soil to let the water not lose in the air. But physiological, like a transpiration, physiological process, can be governed, can be adjusted by the plant. And now we see how. Because transpiration is the water that is loose by the plant through the leaves. No? So, when we talk later about the transpiration of the leaves, we can understand how the plant can work to let the plant not lose too much water, because there are some periods where the evapotranspiration demand is very high, and so the plant is not able to equalize the water that is losing, because there is no water in the soil. So it is losing a lot of water, okay, but is not able to catch water from the soil, because there is so few water in the soil. So in that moment, in that period, the plant has got 2 choices. Or to lose water from the leaf, but it will happen that the plant will be in the wilting point. So it will be in some days or in some weeks, it will dead. Or to let the plant not to lose water, to stop transpiration from the leaves to the atmosphere. But in this case, the plant is stopping also the absorption of water from the soil. So if the plant decide to let the plant not to die, to close the stomata, now I explain the stomata, so to close the way of losing of the water, and in that case, in the same moment, the plant is deciding not to absorb water, because the engine of the plant is the transpirational process. The transpirational process, so the losing of water from the leaf, is necessary to the plant to absorb water from the soil. If not, the plant can't absorb water from the soil. Now, I will explain better. So this is the difference, the deficit that we can observe here in Catania, in Sicily, because, for example, this area is very, very hot. It's one of the areas where it is necessary to irrigate because the demand, the evapotranspiration demand is very high. Here we have nearly, how I told you before, nearly 160 millimeters of water deficit yearly in Cesena. So it's not so much. So in that case, we can decide to irrigate or to use some other activities, some other ways, not to let the plant to be irrigated, but to escape from the risk for the plant to die. And this process of aridity, of ground, of areas that are going to be always more and more arid, is a process that is increasing in Sicily. Here you can see from 1930 of the last century to 2000 of this new millennium, that the areas in yellow and in red, that are the area of desertification, are increasing more and more in Sicily. So what does it mean? It means that the balance of water irrigation and of the policy of the region, just to use the right and available crops in the right area, are not so well organized, are not so focused on the process of desertification that is increasing more and more in the Sicilian region. So it means that we have to change our policies and to better use these areas with the suitable and the better crops that must be used in these desert areas. Here I put again the Europe map just to let understand another things about the water use. So this point, these red points that you can see here in Sicilian region, but also in Italy and in Spain, are the areas where there is a lot of salt intrusion. So salt water from the sea that get inside the areas where we have our water capacity of, we say, good water, the water that you use for irrigation. So this means that these areas are really complicated, because in the every year that go on, we have a lot of problems with the quality of water irrigation. That becoming salty makes a lot of problem, not only in the characteristics of the soil, that is less, is poorer, is less fertile. So it means that we are not able to produce good quality production in the crops that we decided to use in that area. And also that we are decreasing the characteristics of the quality of the production. So not only we have a poorer soil, but we have also a characteristics of the plant with poorer quality characteristics, qualitative characteristics. This map instead is talking about the water exploitation. What is water exploitation? Here we have the definition. The water exploitation index in a country is the mean annual total demand for fresh water divided by the long-term average freshwater resource. It means that the water demand is higher than the water resource. So this index, it means that, and here we see south of Italy and Sicily, it means that we have a severe water stress, because we use more water than what we have in that we are able to use. So, for example, this year in winter, for us, it was really a good year because it rained really a lot. And for us it was like a miracle, a good aspect, because a lot of resources that were decreasing more and more, and also all the people that normally use these resources to irrigate their field were always lower and lower. So also a lot of costs of energy higher to let the water be absorbed by the growers to irrigate their fields. So, for what we have said, we understand that irrigation is something that is really necessary to have production and good quality production. So, we have to give a definition about irrigation. What we can say about irrigation? Irrigation is the application of water to the soil to supplement natural precipitation and provide an environment that is optimum for crop production. So this definition is very big, is very extensive in meaning, in the concept. So when we talk about this kind of irrigation, we are just saying that we are to supplement the natural resource, the natural water that is present in the soil. But in effect, we have to understand that there are different kinds of irrigation, because we can talk about a type of irrigation that is supplementary irrigation, in areas with rainfall for a part of the season of or year. So the irrigation that is made not all over the year, but just in a specific part of the year, or total irrigation in areas of no rainfall. So if we talk about the Mediterranean climate, what we can see? That normally we are in an environment where during winter we have got the quantity of water suitable enough to go on till the springtime. Because if we go back and see, for example, these periods, we can see that the rainfall are higher than the evaporative demand. So in these cases, the irrigation is not necessary. But the problem is the length of the period where irrigation is needed, and more important, the amount. So the difference about irrigation and draining processes. So, which are the aims, which are the objectives of irrigation? So, let me introduce one by one all the objectives of irrigation. So, we have just said that the first, of course, aim is to supply water partially or totally for crop need. So, we have to give back the water that the plant lost. We have talking about the evapotranspiration, so we understand that there is a loss of water from the plant, a loss of water from the plant with the transpiration. But when we talk about the supplement of water partially or totally, we are just talking also about the method of irrigation. Because, and now we will see later, we have to focus how much water we have to give back to the plant. We have to give plant the total amount lost by the plant, or just a part, just partially give back to the plant. This is a strategy that must be understood, well understood, to not have any problem in the organization in the irrigation organization and management of the plant. To cool both the soil and the plant. Another reason, another aim that is needed for irrigation is to let the evaporative evapotranspiration demand become lower and lower. So there are some times, for example, just not only in fruit tree, but I work on tree planting generally. But for example, for tree that are used for ornamental purposes, the cooling of water for the nurseries. You all understand what are the nurseries? In the nurseries is necessary to cool the plant and not have a lot of damages on the leaves, because the water and sun stress can damage the leaves, and in that case, more in the ornamental trees, decrease the price of the plant. So in that case, it's better in some hours of the day to have climatization irrigation, just to let the plant lower its evaporative demand and not want to have any water stress. To leach excess salts, we have introduced also the problems about the quality of the water. There are a lot of areas, for example, just the one in which we are now, so all the province of Ragusa and Siracusa, where the salty quality of the water the salty water is a constant, because there are a lot of intrusion of salty water from the sea, and so we have not so good quality production. So in that case, for example, what the growers have done to overcome this problem? They use such crops that are able to survive with these characteristics of the water, not only to survive, but to have higher quality because of the salty water that is characteristics of this area. So which crop do they produce? They use tomato, or they use also, especially tomato. And I don't know if you all know the cherry tomato. So not only the biggest tomato, but also the tomato that are cherry tomato. In that case, the cherry tomato, thanks to the salty water, has got a better quality because the contrast between sugars and acids is higher, and so the tasty of this product is better. So if this same production is watered with good quality water, we have a lower quality production. So in that case, it is useful to understand which crop is suitable or can be better in that area, because it takes in account that it has got a higher quality. To improve groundwater storage. So another of the problems is the one that we have talked just before. So that this year was very important, because the storage of the groundwater and of the capacitation of the water in the different areas of Sicily has become better and better. And all the growers were thankful to the raining, because in this condition they can have no problem for 2 or 3 years more. And so also the groundwater storage, especially with the irrigation, with the natural rainfall, not only with irrigation, can be very important to overcome some period that can be very stressing for the plant or for the soil. Only to facilitate continuous cropping, so we irrigate also, and we use the irrigation also to have the continuous cropping in the different areas, in different area of production. Also to enhance fertilizer application. So I'm talking about fertigation. Fertigation means that we can put together with water also some nutrient, and in this way have two better characteristics of the plant. To give the nutrient to the plant in lower quantity and to give directly to the plant, because in the meanwhile the plant is absorbing water. As we are giving water together with nutrient, it is with an easy way is able to absorb also the nutrient. This means that a lot of nutrient that normally was distributed in the soil normally was lost in the soil, or worst, it was lost in the groundwater, so in the deep layers of the soil, and this means that there is also a contamination of the water that is used also for civil purposes, and in this case, of course, it is a worst of the characteristics of the water that is present in the groundwater of the area that where we are giving not only water but also nutrient. So what we have to know about when we talk about irrigation? We, to understand all the irrigation, we have to have knowledge, so knowledge on a lot of things. We must know basic soil science and physics, because we have to understand in which kind of soil we are irrigating, because it's very different if we are irrigating in a sandy soil or in a clay soil. Un terreno sabbioso argilloso. So we have to know well the plant and the plant transpirational effects, so the how the plant can go on without irrigation, or how can the plant benefit about irrigation. We must know the water, and when we talk about the water, we must know the quality of the water. So also the characteristics of the water. So another thing that is necessary when we have decided to cultivate a new crop in a new area, we first of all have to do some analysis on the characteristics of the soil and on the characteristics of the soil, of the water. Because understanding it with the water that we are working with and the soil in which we have to cultivate, we can decide if the crop that we were thinking to cultivate is suitable or not, because there are some soils that are suitable for some crops, there are some water that are suitable for some crops, and water and soil that are not completely suitable for the crops that we were thinking for. So it's very, very important the choice of the plant after analyzing the soil and the water characteristics. Another thing very important is the relations of plant, soil, water. So how this water comes from the soil, go through the plant, and arrive to the environment, because it's like a journey of the water through the plant. And so we have to understand how also the physiological process that succeed in a plant from the soil to the environment through the plant. Very quickly, we will talk about also hydraulics, hydrology, and generally engineering principles, just to understand how to organize and also the irrigation in a fruit crop that we can choose together, for example. So, first of all, we will talk about soil and the characteristics of the soil. Which are the constituents of the soil? First of all, the mineral material. So we have to understand in which kind of soil we are working. And of course, we are talking about these 30 different kind of mineral: sand, clay, and silt. We have to know how much organic matter is present in our soil. And of course, this is a characteristic that makes more valuable our soil. Higher is the organic matter, more valuable it will be our soil, because organic matter is a characteristic that makes the soil more fertile and that can absorb and catch the water for a longer time because of the characteristics of the organic matter. That is not typical, for example, in a sandy soil. The water, and when we talk about water, we have to know how much water is present normally in our soil and the characteristics of the water, and how much air is present in our soil. When we talk about air in the soil, we think it's something very negligible, not so important. But the quantity of air in the soil is really, really important, because the air is necessary to the plant and for the roots of the plant not to have problems of no oxygen. That it means that the plant in that case will have a lot of problems, and in that case the environment, I mean the environment for the roots, it will be toxic for the plant, and the plant is always able also to die. So normally this is the optimal proportion of soil constituents. So we can talk about normally 45% of minerals, so sandy soil and silt, 5% normally of organic matter, 30% of water, and 20% of air. This is a soil that has got some optimal characteristics. But when we talk about the minerals, we have to quickly understand which kind, what characteristics must have a soil of different characteristics. So, when we talk about sand soil, which kind of soil is sandy? Normally, we can use two different units: the one of the Americans, the USDA, or the international, that is normally the most used in Europe. So we can talk about this kind of units for this kind of type of soils. So, for example, the same soil, it means that we are talking about the particles from 0.02 millimeters to 2 millimeters. So normally the sandy soils has got the biggest particles. Silt soil are in the medium size, while clay soils are the smallest type of soil with 0.002 millimeters. So, taking into account understanding which kind of difference is between a clay, silt, and sandy soil, we have to understand the interaction that there is with water, with this different kind of mineral constituents. To understand this, we have to understand what is a soil texture. And I want to introduce you this triangle that is very useful to understand which type of soil we can work with. So, for example, the better kind of soil, it will be the one we have said with 50% sand and 30% clay and 20% silt. So when we are in this center of this triangle, the characteristics of soil will be the optimal soil that we can have for each crop that we have. But normally, it's not so easy to have these characteristics. So normally we have a lot quantity of clay, or against we can have a lot of quantity of sand. And now we understand the difference for the water irrigation if we have a sandy soil or a clay soil, for example. So we understood how much the proportion can be used for the optimal soil texture that we have to give for our production. And we have a lot of others types of soil that have got different percentages depending on the quantity that we can have of each of the mineral constituents. So the quantity of water in a soil as determined by its moisture content does not give a true indication of the soil wetness. If we say that we have 50% of wetness, we are not saying nothing. We must understand if we have 50% of water in a sandy soil or in a clay soil. Because the water available for the plant, if we say that we have 50 or 80% of water, is completely different in the two kind of soils. So, a clay soil, which on handling feels dry, can be at the same moisture content as a sandy soil, which feels wet. So, when, for example, we touch a sandy soil wet, we can have the same quantity, the same amount of water in percentage that we have in a clay soil that in at the feeling, in by touching it, it seems really dry. So a plant will have less difficulty extracting water from a sandy soil than from a clay soil at the same moisture content. So the strength with which the soil has got the water in the same moisture content. It means that the plant is not able to absorb this kind of water in this kind of soil. So we have to understand this moisture retention curve. So if we see this is the capacity of the soil to have the water and not to let the plant absorb this water, higher and higher as we go to the right. And this is the quantity of water, so the moisture of the soil, the moisture of the soil that is higher and higher as we got up to the north. So what we see, that the same amount of water that is present, for example, in sand or in clay soil, it means that we have to do a lot of work more if we are in a clay soil to absorb the same amount of water that is in a sandy soil. So it's very, very difficult for a plant to absorb water from a clay soil. And why this happens? Because we have the different kind of adhesion of the water to the particle of the soil. So, if we have in this condition, we have got the gravitational water. So we have got plenty water, a lot of water, and the great amount of the water will go through the soil in the deepest layer of the soil because of gravitational energy. So, in this kind of water, we will be in the condition of field capacity, so in the maximum quantity of water present in the soil, and in this condition, it's very easy for the plant to absorb the water. So this is the maximum soil water content that can be able to be in the soil. Instead, at the contrary, if we are in this condition, we have got higroscopic water. Higroscopic water is so adhesive to the particle of the soil that the plant has got a lot of the difficulty to absorb this water from the soil. So it will have a lot of work to force the plant, force the soil to give the water to the plant. So in this case, we are in a condition that can go through the plant to have a wilting point, cioè un punto di appassimento. The plant wilting point, it means that there is some moisture in the soil, but the water content that is present in the soil is not able to be used by the plant by absorption. Instead, the normal and good water content is the capillary water. The capillary water is an amount of water that is present in our kind of soil, but this is not only of the particles of the soil, but can be used also by the plant that is able to absorb the water from this particle, and so it's a capillary water that depends on the ability of the different crop to absorb this water in greater amount or in lower amount. So, for example, olive has got a great capacity to absorb a lot of water. Some other crops like peach or plum has got not a lot of strength to absorb this water, and so can obtain lower amount than olive. So there are also differences between crops. Some crops has got a higher strength and higher capacity to absorb water. Some crops can't work at some levels of pressure or tension. Now we introduce also another meaning about the tension of the absorption. So here is just to understand so the quantity of water that is available for the plant. So when we say that there is a 10% or 30% or 60% of moisture in the soil, we are not saying how much is the water available really for the plant. Because if we can see here, the field capacity to this area is the part of the water that is really available for the plant. Going through the wilting point, it means that the quantity of water that is available for this plant is lower and lower, and at the end is not available for the plant because there is really captured by the soil, particles of the soil, and is not able to be given to the plant. So, for irrigation management, the acceptable soil water range is generally defined using the available soil water concept, which is the difference between the field capacity and the permanent wilting point. The permanent wilting point, it is what you have said before, the hygroscopic water. So at the hygroscopic water, the plant is not able to absorb also all the moisture that is present in the soil. Instead, in the field capacity, we are in the condition of the gravitational water, and so the availability of water for the plant is plenty, is fully. So the field capacity is the water content at which drainage becomes negligible on a free draining soil. So it's so higher the amount that the water go through the soil in the deepest layers. Well, when we are talking about the permanent wilting point, is the minimum soil water content when plants permanently wilt and at the end can be forced to die. So the soil water stored between the field capacity and the permanent wilting point is called the total available water or available water capacity. So what we must know and must understand about the use and availability of water is the available water capacity, that is the quantity of water that can be really used by the plant. And as we say, for example, it's different between olive and this is kiwi plant, that olive has got the possibility to absorb also in stress condition with a negative potential of the matrix. Now, when we introduce another concept, the potential of the soil to have this water, while other plants like kiwi or grape are not so able to absorb this water from the soil. Another concept is about the movement of the water through the soil. So, for example, this is a sandy soil and this is a clay soil. What we see? That in a sandy soil, the water normally go in deep and it stays available for the plant not for a long time. We can see 15 minutes, 41 hours, 24 hours. So it will be available for a few time in, so only 20 minutes, 1 hour in the layers near to the top of the soil, while it will be present in the deepest area just for example, 24 hours. This doesn't succeed in a clay soil. The water will be available for a longer time, and so the possibility for the plant to absorb the water will be higher also for some days. And so it means that the intervals that in which we use to give water to the plant by irrigation must be, in this case, very frequent, and in this case can be the intervals higher, so longer. So this means that the kind of soils oblige the grower also to define also the interval with a longer or shorter time. And this is very important because not always we have got the availability of water for a long time. So this must be taken into account also. So what happens normally when we irrigate? When we irrigate, we should understand that the water what we are giving must be used only from the roots. So we must determine the quantity of water that we can give that will be used by the roots. It's not useful to give a lot of water for a long time, because the water in surplus that we give will go in deepness and it will not used by the roots. And so we are not using that water, and so we are having higher costs. So we are giving a lot of water that is not used by the roots of the plant, and that in that case it will be in the deepest layer of the soil. The concept, the fundamental concept that must be understood for the movement of the soil, of the water through the soil to the plant, is the hydraulic system. It's like we are talking about an hydraulic system. So the flow of water in any hydraulic system, including the soil plant water system, takes place from a state of higher to one of lower potential energy. So the steepness of the potential gradient from one point in the system reflects the ease with which water will flow down the potential gradient between the points. It's a very difficult concept for a very easy idea. So, which will be the movement of the water in a system? As you know, always the movement of the water will be from a state of higher energy to a state of lower energy. For example, if we have two tanks with different gradients, with different quantity of salt, of course the mixture of water will be the one that at the end of the mixtures it makes the characteristics of the water at the end to be equal to the all the amount of minerals and water present at the beginning. So when we talk about this soil water plant continuum, we are talking about different state of energy that are present in the soil plant atmosphere. So what it happened? That for the roots to absorb water from this soil has got to win this resistance in the soil that can be expressed as a psi, Psi, it means is a unit that we can use, for example, just to describe the tension with which the soil takes the water into the soil and not and let the water not to move through the plant. So less negative, so more negative, so higher will be the strength, more difficult will be for the plant to absorb this water from the soil. But who is the engine to let the water move through the plant? It will be the leaf. In fact, we see that normally the tension that is working into the plant is higher than the tension that is working in the soil.
Siccome I ghanesi cavronensi hanno 4 ore di sonno.
Faccio una pausa.
Sì, magari quando finisco.
Quando finisco il concetto? Sì, sì, sì. Ok. Why we are talking about this? So we are talking about the energy that is necessary to let the water move from the soil through the plant and from the plant through the environment, to the atmosphere. So in this case, as you can see, the demand and the force is higher, so less is more negative in the atmosphere. We can arrive also to minus 500 bars. Like, while in the plant, we are working in these levels of bars, minus 10, minus 20 bars, while in the soil, we are talking about 0.315 bar. So this force, this negative force, is made by leaf transpiration. I explained this last slide, and then we can have a short rest. Leaf transpiration is the force, the engine that makes the water move through the plant. Why this happens? Through the stomata, that are these opening ways that are present in the leaves of the plant, the plant loses by transpiration all the water, but only a small amount of water is used by the plant for the growth and the metabolism. 97% is lost by transpiration. So 97% of the water that goes through a plant is used only for transpiration. The other 3% is used to let the plant grow. So why the plant must use all this water and then discharge, disperse, and not use all the water and lose in the atmosphere? Because this is necessary just to have the plant work for all the metabolism activities. And this can be explained because into the plant there is like a column of the single so of the single water of the single particles of water that has got two energies. One adhesive, so the water is joined to the tubes inside the columns of the plant, and one a force of cohesion. The force of cohesion is like a long column inside the plant that makes the water move through the plant. So it's not important the height of the plant. It can be 1 meter, like 10 meters or 100 meters, the height of the plant. But this force of the single particles of water makes the water move through the plant, and with the stomata in the leaf, it open or close, lets the plant absorb the water through the soil. I will return in this concept just to clarify all the concept, and we can have 10 minutes of rest. Okay. I want to give you some information about an interesting question that arrived from Greece about this slide, and that is useful for everybody just to understand why we are talking about negative values. Because if you can see, we are what we start talking about minutes, minus 10, minus 20, minus 400 bars, and so on. So we have to explain two facts, two concepts. One is about this value, why it is negative. It is negative because normally, this is how I explained it, when we talk about water, the normal movement of water is from above to the ground, because it's the gravitational energy that that makes the flow movement. But in this case, is the opposite movement. Is the same difference that there is between pressure and tension. The pressure is, in this case, made by the gravitational energy, and so it's from above to the ground. The tension is the work that the plant must do to absorb the water from the soil through the plant and arrive to the environment. So is a negative because the pressure is positive and the tension is negative. This is the mathematical explaining, positive and negative. Then the values are always higher and higher. It means always more negative. So it's not higher and higher, it's lesser and lesser, no? Because minus 200, minus 400 is more negative. So it means that the movement is always from a state of energy to the higher state of energy, no? Because the evaporative demand is higher in the environment than in the plant. Then the demand is higher in the plant than in the soil. At the end, if we have higroscopic water, the energy that has got the plant is not enough to absorb water from the soil. But if we have gravitational water, so if we are in the condition of field capacity, the plant can work and absorb water from the soil. So this is the meaning. And at the end, she asked, but the circuit, the balance, when it will be joined? Because it's always more negative, but who gives the energy? Who is that close the balance of the circuit? I said, this is not a balance. The balance of water is, for example, the one that we can determine from the amount of water that is lost from the trees to the plant, and with evapotranspiration, and then is gave back from the environment with draining to the soil. So this is the movement and the balance of water inside the earth. And so at the end, it will be equal. There will not be any destroy and not creation of water. There will be always a balance. In this case, it's not a balance. Who will be the energy of this movement? It's something that is outside from the Earth. It's the Sun. So our Earth has got the balance, but in this case, the energy, the engine that makes the movement of the water is made by the Sun, that during the day, not during the night, because in the night we don't have sun. During the day, makes the leaves open the stomata and so lose water. That's why it's not a balance, because the one that gives energy to the life that is in the earth is always the sun. The engine of life is the sun. In this case, we can understand why it's the sun. It's not a balance. It's something in the world. The sun makes the movement also of the plant with the transpirational activity. So when we talk about this energy, we understand also why it's like a chain of the water. We have talked about the molecules of water, saying that any molecule of H2O has got two kind of energy that makes the water like a chain. This chain is made by the cohesion of the single molecules of water, so H2O, 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 and it makes a long chain through the plant that can't be destroyed, because there is also the adhesion in the xylem. What is the adhesion? Is the capacity of the water to adhere, to stay attached inside the pipes of the tubes of the plant, no? And so these give the opportunity to the plant not to destroy this chain. Through this chain, every molecule that is lost through the stomach of the leaves, through transpiration, makes the plant give the opportunity to absorb a molecule of water in the soil. So, any molecule of water that is lost makes the plant absorb a new molecule of water from the soil. So it's one single chain with water, that is, each molecule of the water is a part of the chain. Is it clear? So this is, of course, made because of the presence of the sun. So it's the sun that makes the plant work and open the stomach and lose water. And we have understood that a great amount of water is lost. 97% is used by transpiration, only for transpiration. So it's like we say that all the quantity of water that is used for the plant is lost. Instead, we are not saying that. It's not lost. It's not completely lost by the plant. It's useful for the plant. It's very important for the plant because it makes the plant work and live. Because during this transpiration, the plant is able to make its own metabolism, to grow, so to make new sugars, proteins, and so on, to construct new parts of the plant, and so to grow. And 1% is consumed in photosynthesis. So, photosynthesis, as you know, is also the main important process of the plant that makes the plant live and be autosufficient to go on. So, just another, talking about a liter, how many millimeters is, and then we understood how many cubic meters is, I want to let you understand also the pressure and tension, how it is measured, and which unit we can use. As you can see, when we are talking about plant, we always use this MPa, that is megapascal. So pascal is the unit for pressure or tension, and mega means thousands of pascal. No, so we normally can use also bars, that is another unit. So one bar, it corresponds to 0.1 megapascal. So now that we introduce another equation, that is the equation with which the plant works into the environment, we have to understand how much is a bar and how much is a megapascal to better understand how it works. The second water volumes, I put it again, but I know that you just know it with before. So this is the water potential equation. This equation is the one that we before explain with this movement, no? But we must know all the segments of the single factor that contribute to the equations, to the water potential equation. That is the, always this this letter that is a Greek letter, C, C of the water. So the water that is the water potential. The water potential is the sum of these four potentials that are the osmotic potential, the target pressure potential, the gravitational potential, and the matrix potential. Now I will explain it better. So, the osmotic potential is also said as the solid potential, that is the meaning of the content of the turgor present inside a cell, and it depends on the content of minerals that are present inside the water, inside the solid. The target pressure inside the plant cell is also said Cp, so it's the second value of the sum. The gravitational potential and the matrix potential, that is the thin layers interacting with soil particles. So it's the water that is adhesive to the soil particles of the soil. Most of the time, the potential, the gravitational potential, the matrix potential, are so small that are not taken in account. So they are ignored. So normally, when we are talking about the water potential equation, we only sum the osmotic potential and the target pressure potential, giving the single gravitational potential reflects the force, the gravitational forces of the solid water. So is what we have before explained about the movement of water. Normally, water acts with a movement that is from the above to the ground. So this gravitational potential has got a negative value that must be won by the plant to let the plant go upright. So from the ground to the air. Pressure potential is positive when greater than atmospheric pressure and negative when below atmospheric. So the pressure potential is the one that must be always taken in account per, to have the values that we have read before. So when we have read 0.3 or 15 bars in the soil, or when we have seen, for example, minus 10, minus 20 bars in the plant, we are talking about the pressure potential, that in this case is the tension potential, because as I explained before, is the force that must be worn by the plant. Is dotic is also known as matrix potential. It is characteristic of soil water above a free water surface. And then we have the osmotic potential that reflects the effect of solids in soil water in the presence of a semi-permeable membrane. Of course, the water that is present in the soil is not without elements, without mineral elements, is with mineral components. Higher is the quantity of the mineral components that makes that are present in the soil, higher is the osmotic potential. So it means that more salty is the water present in the soil, higher is the force that the plant must be must do to be able to absorb the water from the soil. So the total potential of soil water at a point is the sum of all the components of potential which are acting. The movement of water in the soil is low, so kinetic energy is neglected. So it means that always all the movements from the soil to the plant is due to the capacity of the plant to win these forces that are present inside the soil. And of course, higher are these forces, higher is the osmotic potential inside the soil. Of course, this it means that when we irrigate the plant, we always have to give back the water that is used by the plant to transpirate. It means that we must understand how much water we have to give each time we water the plant. So it's important not only when to irrigate, but how much you irrigate and how often you irrigate, because it makes the sense on the usefulness of the irrigation by the grower. A way that is used more and more in the tree crops is the Schlander pressure chamber. The Schlander pressure chamber is a very old machine, if we can say. It's a pressure chamber that is used in the 70s. But till now is the one that makes sense, because it is a way to ask to the plant in which hydraulic state is the plant. So the plant is in stress, the plant is well watered. We don't want to know if we are giving a lot of water to the soil. We want to know if the water that we are giving to the soil is used by the plant, and so if the plant is in stress condition, or is well watered, and so it in a good hydraulic state, so it hasn't got a stress, a water stress. How we can know it? Only asking to the plant. Only giving a measurement of the hydraulic state of the plant. How we can it works, this pressure chamber? It's very easy. Before to explain it, I want to again repeat what happened in the leaves. The leaves lose the water through the stomata with the tension. So if we want to know how it worked with the value of the negative value with which the leaves were working, we have to do a normal measurement, giving back the pressure with which the leaves was working for the tension. So when the balance between the pressure that we put inside this camera, this chamber, and the tension with which the leaf was working, we will notice something in this cut. I explain you better. So we take a twig, germoglio, we take a twig and we put inside this chamber, that is a little chamber of this height, more or less, and we let go out only the twig of the plant, only a little part. So then we have a bomb, a gas cylinder, and we put air into this chamber. Putting air into this chamber, we are giving pressure inside the stomata of the leaves, and so it will. We will see at the end a drop of water going out in this cut of the plant, of the twig. What it happened when we see the drop? It happened that we balance the energy, or better, the tension with which the leaf was working. Because if I go back into the slide, we see that the plant was working, for example, at minus 10 or minus 20 bars. So if we are giving inside the chamber the same forces with the pressure, we balance when the water will drop. So this is a way to investigate and to ask to the plant how it was working. More negative is the value, and then the value, you can read it, the value in pressure gauge, in a manometer. In the pressure gauge we can read the value, and we exactly know how the plant was working. If the value was more negative, minus 5, minus 10, minus 20 bars, it means that the work was higher, and so the plant was in higher stress condition. So, for example, is a useful way to understand when to irrigate, when to begin irrigate, because if the plant goes each day in stress, we have to go and irrigate it. So, for example, we normally measure after a week after irrigation. We measure it, and if it doesn't arrive a negative value, we don't give water. So we normally know for each species, but not only for each species, but also for each cultivar, the value, the right value to irrigate the plant. We know by asking to the plant its hydraulic state when to begin to irrigate, or when to irrigate each 10 days, every week, and so on. So this is the best way to understand when is better to irrigate, because it's a plant-based method. It's not a method that is due to the, for example, characteristics of the soil and on the quantity of the soil of water in the soil. He's just asking to the plant if it is or not in stress. So we, as we irrigate, as we say, to let the plant not have this problem, but to be in good condition, before that the plant arrives in this condition, we always irrigate, having always the good, optimal water status of the plant. So, for example, just to better understand what it absorbs, what it happens, is the daily water movement in the plant. So what we can see here, that the blue line is the absorption of water from the soil, while the purple line is the transpiration in the leaves. So what we can see, that there is an hysteresis, so it means a retardo. This hysteresis, it means that before the plant is able to absorb, and before absorbing there is the higher values of transpiration, because it opens the stomata, it begins transpiration, the chain of the water inside the plant moves the water in the chain of inside of the plant, at the end it arrives to the roots, and the roots begin to absorb. So that's why it begins the transpiration, and after a few it begins to absorb. But it's later than the transpirational process. Understand? In the same time, what we can see, these are the values from 6 a.m. to 12 midnight, what it happened for the leaf water potential. So the measurement that we can do with the Schlander pressure chamber. So with the Schlander pressure chamber, every, for example, 2 hours, we measure what is the water stress, the hydraulic state of the plant, and we can see that, of course, during the night it is quite near to zero, and during the day it arrives also to 0.9 megapascal. So what it happens? That during the day, of course, the plant is always in a worse hydraulic state than during the night. So the moment, the right moment, the right period, just to ask the plant its hydraulic state, is to make this measurement in pre-dawn, at pre-dawn. What is pre-dawn? All'alba, prima dell'alba. Why we have to measure it at pre-dawn? We have to measure it at pre-dawn because, of course, after all the night, the balance of the hydraulic state of the plant is the best one, because it recovered all the stresses that it has done the day before, during the day. So these values is the one that in which we have to measure the water state of the plant and know its value. So, for example, when we do some investigation and do want to know if we are good, we are doing a good practice of the cultivation, of, for example, of stress irrigation, or for example also of nutrient or treatments for the plant. For example, we are doing some nutrient to the leaves and see if the plant behaves better. We can measure these values at pre-dawn and know if it has got a more positive value, and it means that the plant is in less water stress condition. Of course, I want to focus the fact that is different this value for each species and inside for each species, for each cultivar. So, in a great way, we can see, for example, that the olive is able to reach values more negative than peaches, and peaches more negative than grape and kiwi. What does it mean? That of course, the capacity, the ability of each species is completely different. There are some species that can survive, can stay in very stress condition for a long time because they can reach higher, I mean, less, more negative values for a longer time. Some species must be watered more frequently and with higher amounts. So that's why it's important the choice of the species for the suitable environment. So the ability of olive to give water from its leaves through respiration, both under water scarcity and in optimal condition, is greater than in other three species. By reducing leaf water potential, is able to reduce its water potential and maintain its negative water potential for a longer time. This process permits the photosynthesis even during periods of high water scarcity. So it's able to do it also for a long time, also with no rain. This explains why, for example, not only in Sicily, but also in Greece and in all the Mediterranean area, normally olive was one of the best crop to be used in desert condition, where the impossibility to have to reach a great amount of water, but in any case to give only a part of water in certain phenological phases was the best choice for this environment. Of course, what it happened during the day, as you have seen also in the corridors in this school, we are going now not only to have good and high production, but to have high quality production. To obtain high quality production and to obtain, for example, the POD, the protected origin of the production, for example, of some oil olive, we must, in this case, try to reach the best quality of the fruits. In this case, we more and more are irrigating our olives because we have a big problem. We have a big problem because we cannot compete with some areas where the workers costs really less than in Europe or than in Italy, and so the only way to compete with this area where the workers has got a lower cost is to have a better quality, so we can reach some markets and that then will prefer our product, and so in this case the irrigation is one of the strategies that is helpful to obtain this challenge, this aim. So for example, this is the values that we can measure at per down. So if it in peach, in plum, in apricot, what is well irrigated, we have values, for example, of minus 0.4, and when we are in water stress, minus 0.7. But in grape and kiwi, of course, the values are more positive, less negative. It means that they are nearest to zero. So we, in this case, we have minus 0.2. Or in conditions of water stress, we can reach also always values of minus 0.5. This makes you understand the difference between these species and olive, that is one of the best crop for a condition of high stress condition. Another way of measure the water is the soil water balance, the one that we were talking about before when we thought about the balance. So if we want to know, for example, in a long period, not for a day, the water amount that was given and the water balance in an area, we can use this equation, where the FG is the gross irrigation required during the period. So the gross irrigation is the sum of this single segment. ETC, that is the amount of crop evapotranspiration during the period, so is the quantity of water lost by the physical, so the soil, and by the plants. So it's the sum of the water lost by the soil and by the plant. The P, that is the deep percolation from the crop root zone during the period. So it's the water that is lost in the deepest layers of the soil. So it's the water that is not joined to the particle of the soil, that is lost because of too much water arrived in a unit of time. Plus RO, that is the surface runoff that leaves the field during the period, because a part of the water is not able to arrive inside the soil, but is lost in the surface of the ground, and is lost in the for most of the times in the lakes or in the rivers. P, that is the total precipitation during the period. Of course, these are the sum, while P is negative, because of course we have to take into account that is a quantity of water that is given to the soil. So precipitation must be not summed, not be a sum, but is less into this balance. GW, that is groundwater contribution to the crop root zone during the period. So we have to take in account also the moisture content of the water into the soil. And the DSW, that is the change in soil water in the crop root zone during the period. So in this equation, we can have all the contribution of each segment of the equation, and to understand how much is the quantity of water that is present in our environment in a long period. It can be used, of course, for a long term evaluation of what water goes where for determining contributions to downstream surface water and groundwater. So this is not used for the organization and the calculation that must do a grower, but is just to understand in an area, in a great area, what it happened for the water amount present in that area. Of course, the most important value that is used is the reference crop evapotranspiration method. This is the one that is the most used in our condition, but I want to say all over the world. So the reference crop evapotranspiration method uses two factors to predict actual crop water use. That is KC, that is the crop coefficient, and ET con zero, that is the evapotranspiration for a grass reference crop. By this multiplication, we can obtain the quantity, the amount of water that must be given in a particular crop. What we can use for this equation? We must know what is ET con zero. The reference crop is generally represented by either grass or alfalfa. So we must measure how much is the evapotranspiration, the potential evapotranspiration, by measuring by this way. So the sum in a certain area of cultivation with a grass is the ET con zero that is based climatically, and multiplying this potential evapotranspiration per il coffee set cultural, we have the evapotranspiration of the crop. And then, if we want to better understand the actual evapotranspiration, we must multiply the evapotranspiration, the potential evapotranspiration, per il coefficient cultural, per il by the stress coefficient. The stress coefficient is a stress value that is used for special phenological phases. So the evaporation of the pan is the one that we normally use to have the eticon zero, the evapotranspirational or the potential evapotranspiration. So the potential evapotranspiration is the amount that is lost, for example, in a week or in 10 days by this pan, and we measure the millimeters, the millimeters of water lost in this amount of time, in a week or 10 days, and then we is the quantity that is normally lost in that environment. Of course, hottest is that environment, higher is the amount that is lost in by this pan. So in this case, we can measure the evapotranspiration, the maximum evapotranspiration of this area. The important thing is that you can see here around, we have this kind of grass. This kind of grass must be always well cultivated because it's the area that is more suitable to be all the same if we measure it here in Modica or in some part in Africa or in all over the world. So the condition of the environment around this pan must be always the same, just to standardize all the conditions of the environment. What we have to use for the multiplication is the crop coefficient. The crop coefficient, as you can see, is different for each species. For example, here we have almonds, apples, apricots, avocados, citrus, and so on. But as you can see, it's different also depending on the amount of canopy and the area covered by the canopy through the soil. So the highest is the canopy and higher is the plant. Of course, we can see that the crop coefficient is higher. So in case it's 20% canopy is 0.5, in case it's 70% of canopy, it's 0.7 of crop coefficient. Then you can see that we have a crop coefficient that is different between the initial stage, middle stage, and the end stage. So what does it mean? Of course, the quantity of the crop coefficient is not always the same during the year, but is higher in spring, in summertime, and lower in spring and autumn time. So you can see always that the values in the middle, crop coefficient in the middle, is always higher than the one at the initial and the end of the stages. So this is a way just to have a better value that, of the single crop coefficient. Then you can see, for example, that citrus is very different, the values between citrus and apricot. For example, in the apricot, the values are always lower than in citrus. Why this happen? For two reasons. Because there are differences between the plants that has got leaves all over the year and plants that has got leaves only for six or eight months, no? Because, of course, apricot or apples or peaches has got leaves not all over the year, but only for some months. And then of course, because the quantity of water that is lost is completely different, because citrus are from origin a subtropical species, so is able to reach some stress condition better than, for example, apricot, peach, or stone fruit in general. Another, this that I showed you is, for example, the FAO, FAO, a card that is used all over the world. So it's the same values that are well considered, not only in Italy, but from USA to Africa. For example, here there is the values of crop coefficient that are more specific in depending for each month of the year, and depending also on the weed control. So if the weed are cleaned, so the soil is clean, or if there is if there is weeds in the soil. So in this case, the crop coefficient changes really a lot, and the values change also depending on the tree ground cover. So all this crop coefficient must be used depending on the different condition in which we are assuming that these one are the one that best represents our conditions. Now I want to introduce the methods of irrigation. I mean that, of course, there are different ways of use the different irrigation and different methods that can be used depending on the characteristics of the soil and depending on also the kind of crop that we are cultivating. So, the selected irrigation technique has great importance in limiting water use and also unleashing of nutrients in soil. These are the most important. So, flooding, furrow, sub-irrigation, sprinkling, micro-irrigation, can be also drip or micro-jets. Of course, going from this one to this one, the amount of water needed is less and less. It means that in this case, in flooding, we need a lot of amount of water, while in micro-irrigation, like in drip irrigation, we can use a lower amount of water, but in that case, we have got higher amount of investments to let the water move inside the field. Another different characteristics of the water distribution is the efficiency of this different water distribution. So, going from flooding to through micro irrigation, the percentage of efficiency is higher and higher. Why? Because in the case of flooding, we are giving a lot amount of water into the soil, and of course, less than 50% is the quantity or the amount of water that is absorbed by the roots. So that's why here we have values less than 50%, and in micro irrigation, like in drip irrigation, we are giving water just in a defined part of the soil, and in that case, the quantity of water that is lost or through evaporation or through percolation is very, very little. In the case of flooding, the water lost by percolation is more than 40-50%. So, for example, this one is the flood irrigation of citrus that is used to be done, for example, in some part of Florida or in California, more in Florida. But we are not used to do this kind of irrigation for two reasons. Here, one, because we don't have this amount of water available to do this kind of irrigation. Why? Because, for example, some parts of our soils, for example, near Catania, for example, near Mount Etna, the soil are really sandy, are volcanic soil. So the water would be available for the plant for only a short period, and so a lot of water will be lost by percolation, and a lot of minerals will be leached down in the soil. So, for example, this is surface irrigation of pistachio trees. That is always a condition where there is availability of great amount of water. So, going through each method of irrigation, this is furrow irrigation. Furrow irrigation, of course, needs that the land must be leveled and graded for furrow irrigation. So we need leveled ground, and so not always is possible to do this kind of irrigation. This is, for example, the kind of irrigation that was used for citrus in the 60s, the 70s in Italy, in Sicily, but now is not used. Is not this kind of irrigation is not used. Because, of course, we try to have better methods that permit to have a best efficiency in irrigation. Planting trees on berms, narrow raised beds, or on leaves permit that the tree crowns are above the high water level and the protection from crown rot organisms. One of the problems of the contact of the water with the crown of the plant is that there was a lot of problem due to Phytophthora. Phytophthora, for example, is a rot that when the water is in contact with the plant is very, very problematic, because can determine the death also of the plant. So, one of the way to overcome this problem was to have raised beds, or to put the soil just around the crown, just to not let the water to be in contact with the plant. With furrow irrigation, the number of furrow and the distance between them within tree rows depend on soil texture. So the distance within tree rows depends on the characteristics of the soil. Of course, in the sandy soil, we can have a narrow rows, and in clay soils we can have larger spaces. So also this kind of irrigation determine also the number of plant that can be put in a hectare. Just to have a calculation, then we can do if we want a rest. If we say that, for example, we have a spacing in our field, by citrus or whatever you want, of a distance of 5 meters by 5 meters. How many plants there will be in a hectare? So, let's do the operation together. If we have the space within the rows and between rows 5 meters by 5 meters, how much is the space for each plant?
This depends on the kind of plants.
No, I'm saying how many plants there will be in 1 hectare. How much? Sorry? No, I'm not saying which is the best distance between plants, because it depends. It depends on a lot of things, the best distance. It depends on the rootstock, it depends on the variety of the species. So, because there are some species that has got a great growth, and species with a low growth. So, In citrus, just to say, the best spacing is not possible, just to say. It can be 3 meters, it can be 4 meters, it can be 5, or also 6 or 7 meters between rows. It depends also if you are mechanizing all the activities, all the operation in the soil, or if you do it by hand. So also this is a way to have the best spacing. But what I'm asking you is another thing. If you know the spacing in a field, I said 5 by 5 because it's an easy way, but you can do 5 by 4 or 5 by 3. How, at the end of the operation, how do you calculate the quantity of trees that there is in a hectare, in each hectare?
400.
Huh?
400.
But I want to. 400 is.
How do you
multiply?
Five by five.
What you obtain? 25. Yes, but what is 25? What? 25.
Meters.
Square meter. So 25 square meter is the space that is used by each plant.
Yes, for each
plant. No, because in that case, if we have got. If we got, these are the plants. If we got 5 meters and 5 meters, no? It means that each plant, this is a plant, has got 25 meters. But which are these 25 meters? 2.5 meters. So this area is 25 square meters, no? So this is the area that is occupied by the canopy and, of course, of the roots of the plant. But in this case, that is 25 square meters, in a hectare, how many plants there will be?
You must divide.
You must divide what to what? So each plant occupy 25 square meter. How many plants we have in a hectare?
You must divide 1,000 square meters to 25.
Where divide?
You divide the 25 meters by one hectare, right?
At the opposite. You divide the whole hectare, that is. If this is 1 hectare, 1 hectare is 10,000 square meter. You divide for the distance. So in this case is what, 400. If it was 4 by 5, this was 20, and so 10,000 divided by 20 is 500. Okay? So, in any case, when you want to know how many plants you have in a hectare, you must know the spacing for each plant. Then you obtain the space that is occupied for each plant. And then you divide the whole area, an acre, an hectare, divided by the square meter occupied for each plant. In that way, you know how many plants you have in that area. Okay? With the rest? Pause. That we can use to determine when to water and when to irrigate. So, for example, these are some plant-based measures that we can see. We have talked about pressure chamber, and we understood how easy and how rapid and quick is the way to obtain a value that is the hydraulic state of the plant. One other plant-based method is the subflow. It is a way just to measure the flux of the sap inside the plant. And these kind of sensor different from there are different kind of sensor. This one is one of the that can be used. There are other that measures the movement of the sap inside the plant, and it's very useful because it's the actual movement of the plant. It's not something obtained by depression, so it's not something that is destructive, labor intensive, that must be done at breakdown. So I've done it for a lot of years, but I had to go up in the morning at 2 a.m. not to go down, not to go to sleep, but to go to work. And so it's very hardy, it has a positive fact that is a direct measure of water need. This kind of measurements is continuous because you put it in the plant, you need a charge, you need energy, so you must use the sun with the energy batteries just to recharge it. Or if you have where to plug, you need the energy just to have 365 days in a year all the movements of the sap in the flow of the sap in the plant. But of course it's an indirect measure of water need because you are estimating, you are not measuring directly the water movement because how it works. It makes hot in a part of the plant and it measure after how long it is hot in a higher part of the plant. So it's an indirect measurement, but it is used always more and more. One of the plant-based measurements that is going always more used is the maximum daily trunk shrinkage, that are this kind of claps that you can put, for example, in a fruit or, for example, also in a trunk, and it measures the microns. The microns, that is a millionth part of the millimeters, of the shrinkage of the movements of the trunk or, for example, of a fruit. So what it measures. During the day, for example, the fruit, it doesn't grow. It begin smaller. Why? Because the water inside the cells of the fruit are given to the leaves that transpirate, and in the night, when the plant is in balanced state, the water go back to the fruit. So it measures the shrinkage, so the movements that is negative during the day and more positive during the night. So we can measure each day the growth of the fruit, but it's not always a positive value. It can be during the day also negative because of the water movement inside the plant, no? And always this kind of measurements is continuous, but also in this case you must have a reference because it's an indirect measure of water need. So at the end of the plant-based methods, this one is the one that gives you the best results and the best answers to what you are asking to the plant. Other kind of measurements is not asking to the plant, but asking to the soil. No? You can ask to the soil the water amount. So there are, for example, some instruments like this one that give you the neutron probes, that gives you the water volume, that is so the moisture of the soil, so the water volume present in the soil. Or this kind of instruments like the tensiometer, so the watermark block, gives you the tension with which the water is present into the soil. So it gives you the values in psi, in tension, and you can always use these values to determine the moment in which you have to irrigate. So this kind of example of instruments are sometimes not well considered because they are very very ancient. I mean, we use it in 1960 or 1970s, but they give you a exact and determined water, determined value that is useful to determine when to water, when to irrigate. The problem is that you must control and monitor if it is working well, because sometimes the values can be not good, so you have to put the water inside and have a maintenance well done to have good values and proper values. The third kind of monitoring, just to obtain and determine when to monitor, is the weather monitoring. So, plant monitoring, soil monitoring, or climate monitoring. So, we are working about soil, plant, atmosphere, continuum. In this case, we can use one of these formula, like Arrivi-Samani and Mann-Monteith, that taking into account, for example, temperature, water, precipitation, wind velocity, temperature of the soil, and with the calculating all the balance of the energy inside the heat flux inside the atmosphere, it gives you the amount of water in megajoule that is present in that environment. For example, all the data that we obtain through internet are measured with these climatic formulas. So they apply in the different environment. They have some stations that measures all the components of the formula, and then they apply this formula just to evaluate the amount of water needed in that environment. It's very easy because it's something I would say electronic, because the station measures it for you, it gives you a value, you obtain the value in the PC, you don't have to do anything, but it's something that doesn't give you information about the characteristics of the plant, of the soil. So it's only depending on the climate and on the environment demand. So it's useful, but then I think that you have always to consider also the plant that is the one that you are working for, no, at the end. This one, remote sensing, is one of the newest way of measuring the moment or the period when to irrigate. It doesn't say you how much to irrigate, because it says you, for example, the evapotranspiration. So it's saying you in that environment with some photos made from from the remote sensing, the conditions in that area. Some of these captions can be done every week, every month, and then you can determine the moment when to irrigate. It's always more and more used for great areas. So I mean, for example, from regional services that are trying to give information to a region. So, but are information of great dimension. If you want to know some information about your field and your crops, it's something that can help you, but not give you the right values, the right quantity. I want to close with the deficit irrigation. Deficit irrigation is a watering strategy proposed many years ago to improve water productivity and reduce the irrigation application. We have talked today about the amount of water that you have to give back to the plant, because we have said that the plant loses water and we give back the water that the plant is losing. But in effect, more and more we are considering that deficit irrigation is the way to better behave with the plant, because we don't need to give all the water that the plant loses. Because by giving only a part of the plant of the water that is lost by the plant, we are not only saving water and energy cost, but we are most of the times increasing the water, the quality aspects of the production. I mean, for example, sugars. I mean, for example, anthocyanins or polyphenols of the fruit. I mean, for example, so nutraceutical aspects of the fruit. Most of the times, when the plant is in low stress, the capacity of the plant to produce these polyphenols that at the end of the fact are the defense components to some stresses. If we provoke a stress with deficit irrigation, we let the plant do have higher quantity of these polyphenols. And so we gain two aims, two objectives. One, to have better quality, because the plant is, the fruit is with more sugar. But most important, and most important because is what is asked by the consumers in the last years, is to enhance, and so is to increase, the characteristics of the polyphenols and the antioxidant activity of the fruit. If we can give this information to the consumers by obtaining these better quality fruits, of course these can help us to have a better qualitative production. These are the three different strategies for deficit irrigation. RDI, PRD, DI, which are the difference in deficit irrigation of this kind of irrigation. Regulated deficit irrigation is the use of water stress to control growth and vegetative fruit competition. It consists of applying water in quantities below those necessary to satisfy evapotranspiration of the crop during certain periods of the crop cycle when production and crop quality are hardly affected. What does it mean? We give less water not in the whole period, but only when the stress is less negative to the plant. It means in some phenological stages where the plant is not sensible. Just to understand, these are the species and these are the phenological phases that are more sensible to the stress, to water stress. So, for example, citrus, we don't have to do the deficit irrigation during flowering fruit set, but after fruit set, during fruit growth, we can do deficit irrigation. So, after July, in July, August, and September, we can do deficit irrigation because it is not problematic to the plant. We must not do it in April or in June when there is the flowering of fruit set. So, the first strategy, RDI, is to irrigate only when the plant is not sensible to water stress, stress the plant when the phenological stages are not critical for water stress. Second strategy, PRD. PRD is partial root drying. What does it mean? Maintaining approximately half of the root system sufficiently watered while the other part is allowed to dry. Both halves are watered alternatively every so often. It means that when we irrigate, we must have two lines of irrigation, and we alternatively irrigate one part of the plant and the week after the other part of the plant. So we are halving, we are giving half of the water, and we are determining a little stress to the plant, determining to the plant a work only with half part of the roots. 1 week in half of the roots, 1 week in one half of the other part of the plant, of the roots. So in that way, we are giving a lot of saving of water, and determining a little stress that we measure how with the chamber pressure, with the Schrander chamber pressure. And we have seen that there is a little stress, but not so important for the plant, and there is not a decrease in production. Instead, there is an increase in polyphenols synthesis. Last is deficit irrigation, normal deficit irrigation, that is distribution of the water deficit uniformly over the whole crop cycle to avoid the occurrence of severe water stress at any particular moment, which might have unfortunate results. What does it mean? We measure the actual evapotranspiration of the crop, and then, for example, we know that citrus needs, for example, 100 millimeters in the whole cycle. We decide to give a deficit irrigation giving 20% less of the water in the whole cycle. So if it is 200 millimeters, we give 20% less, it means 160 millimeters instead of 200, that is 20% less. And it means that each irrigation, each interval, we give always 20% less of the actual evapotranspiration that we measure with the PAN method or with the climatic formula. In that case, we determine a constant stress that determines a little decrease in production that is in cost less than what we save in water. So at the end of the economic balance, we saved more water and more costs than the decrease in production of the plant. So also if we decrease a little bit the production, the saving is higher because the saving of the water cost is higher. And as you can see, in each region and in different crops, this kind of deficit irrigation are more and more used in the different, not only tree crops, but also in other crops like potato, wheat, and so on, giving good results in a different region of the world. So I think that just because we are working and we in the different part of Africa and in Sicily, where the evaporative demand is very high, the amount of water available often is not so high, this kind of methods of desert irrigation must be well understood and well applied to have a good saving and better characteristics of the production in terms of quality that gives you the opportunity to open new markets. Okay? Thank you for your attention, and I hope you will see you again.